Hi friends, now we will discuss on the topic renewable energy, biomass and waste part 3. So, previously we have discussed on biomass and waste in part 1 and part 2, and chemical routes and biological routes we have discussed, and here we will discuss on physical routes which is used for making the biomass and waste suitable for its applications in reactors or in say thermal applications. Like see, if I want to use the biomass and waste in incinerator or in gasifiers, then we need to make it in a usable form. That means normally the biomass and waste are having less density and it is difficult to handle in real reactor system. So, this physical process helps to make it harder, give some particular strength and safe also, and it becomes easy to use in the conversion process like incineration, gasification, etcetera. So, the content of this class is the physical conversion of biomass and waste for energy use, and that is we will be giving some focus on the densification of biomass and wastes. So, our objective will be to densify the biomass and waste to give certain strength, certain properties which are more desirable for applications in energy production by this feedstock. So, the definition of densification will be like this. The densification is the process of increasing the density of something. It makes a fuel denser and gives more uniform properties with respect to the raw form. So, this is the main objective of the densification, and densification can be done by some mechanism, that is your compaction or compression and concentrations and concretion. So, these are the steps which helps to perform the densification process. So, here we even put some material here, and if we press it, then it will be densified. And the advantage of this process is that this is very simplified mechanical handling and feeding, and uniform combustion in boilers, the feed will be having almost uniform properties, and then reduced dust productions, reduced possibility of spontaneous combustions in storage, and then simplified storage and handling infrastructure, lowering capital requirements at the combustion plant, and reduced cost of transportation due to increased energy density. So, these are the advantage, and disadvantage is that the major disadvantage to biomass densification technologies is the high cost associated with some of the densification processes. So, we will see that densification processes are costlier in some cases, and in some cases it is not that costlier and people use that also. Then we will see the mechanism. So, you see the figure here, the molecular forces, van der Waals forces can be responsible for the binding, electrostatic forces can be responsible for the binding, or interlocking, there will be some particles and those can be under pressure that can be interlocked, or there will be some if we add some additives, then hardening binders, highly viscous binders, then also adsorption, make some adsorption layer and binders connect the particles and the of the biomass and waste and makes them strong. So, these are different processes which are responsible for the densification of the biomass and waste. So, for this process, for densification process, we need some pressure, high pressure is required, or we may add some binder. When we use binder, then the pressure requirement is less, and where we do not use binder, then pressure requirement is high. So, when the material is compacted with low to moderate pressure, then the space between the particles is reduced. If pressure is increased at certain stage particular to each material, the cell walls of the cellulose constituent are collapsed. Then the pressures required to achieve such high densities are typically 100 megapascal. So, if we apply very high pressure, then the cellulosic materials may be coming out and they can help for binding the particles. But a binding agent is necessary to prevent the compressed material from springing back and eventually returning to its original form. If we do not use binders for at low pressure repetitions, initially the particles may be compressed and again it will be springing back. So that is why binder is required. And additives of high viscous bonding media such as tar, molasses and other molecular weight organic liquid can form bonds very similar to solid bridges. So these are the mechanism. And adhesive forces at solid liquid interface and cohesion forces with the solid are used for binding. So there are, if it is a solid and liquid interface, there will be adhesive forces, and solid solid interface there will be some cohesive forces. So these forces are responsible for the binding, and the binding agent can be either be added to the process, or when compressing ligneous material be part of the material itself in the form of lignin that we are talking about, that if we apply very high pressure, then lignin material can help to bind the biomass and waste particles. So after the application of pressure, we will be getting the dense biomass and waste, and that will be either in pellet forms or maybe in briquettes forms. The pellets are relatively smaller diameter, smaller size, and briquettes are bigger size. So that is typical definition, or we can say the that is a typical limit of the diameter on the basis of which this can be said as briquettes or pellets, that is equal to 30 millimeter. If diameter is greater than 30 millimeter, we can say it as briquettes, and if it is less than 30 millimeter, it is pellets. But this is the rough distinction, and it is arbitrary also. So the factors which influence the densification we will discuss now, and the physical properties, that is moisture content, bulk density, void volume, as well as thermal properties of the biomass are the most important factors in the binding process of the biomass densification. So what are the moisture content, bulk density and void volume, and the thermal properties also are responsible for this. And the ultimate density of a briquette will depend on, to some extent, on a range of factors, including in most importantly the nature of the original material and the machine used for this operation and the conditions we have used. And on that basis, we can have three types of briquetting process. One is your low pressure compaction with a binder, and then medium pressure with a heating, medium pressure compaction with a heating, and high pressure compaction. So there are three options the people have used for this binding process. And in case of low pressure, up to 5 megapascal, and then up to intermediate it is 5 to 100 megapascal, and high pressure means 100 megapascal pressure or more. So when we use the high pressure, then sufficient lignin is released, which helps to agglomerate the particles to form the briquette. And intermediate pressure machines may or may not require binders depending on the material, nature of the material. And low pressure machines positively require binders. So these are three types of briquetting machines and briquetting processes. So high and medium pressure operation, if we consider, then high and medium pressure compaction normally does not use any additional binder, as you have discussed. And then the briquetting process is based either on piston press or screw press. So mostly piston press or screw press. Apart from this, there are some other also, roller press and pellet mill. So roller press and pellet mill can also be used, but these are having initial high investment cost. These require high initial investment cost, and that is why this is not implemented in developing countries. So these are also having high capacity, but biomass and waste are scattered source. So these are collection of these, and then to convert it into this, that is not practiced. So in a small sector, this is collected and produced. So bigger scale machines is not used in developing countries. In this case, that we get the piston press or screw press based machines. Now we will see the piston press. So here the figure shows the piston press. So this is the piston. So here will, if we put the feedstock, so feedstock will get under gravity, it will go down, and when it will come in, entering here, so this piston will have back and forth movement, and this will be pressed here. So this we are getting the bricket. So here the piston can give us very high pressure. So the quality of this, we can, the density of the this material will be very high with respect to other method. And something piston press punch the feed material into a die with very high pressure, either mechanically by a reciprocating ram powered by the massive flywheel, or by hydraulic driven piston. So hydraulic driven pistons, any mechanical arrangement is made, and then this pressure developed here and we get the bricket. Now we will see the screw press. So this is the figure which shows the operation of screw press. So we will feed the feedstock here, and then the screw is moving. So when the screw moves, then it gives some forward movement to the materials, and materials moves towards this where the die is there. So here the material is coming and pressure is developed. So high pressure developed, then here there is some bracket arrangement. So bracket is going out due to the pressure. Here the diameter is high, here diameter is less, so there will be some pressure. So this pressure will also help to get the material out, we will get the bracket here. So this is the mechanism of the operation of the screw press or the screw extruder. So in a screw press, the screw extruder, the rotating screw takes the material from feed port through the barrel and compacts it again a die, which assists the build up of a pressure gradient along the screw. So that we have discussed just now, and it consists three distinct zones. So here we are getting the feeding zone, then it is your transport zone, and this zone is our extrusion zone. Here it is extrusion zone. Now the performance of the process will depend upon some factors, that is your the ability and cohesion of the feed material, and then the particle size and its distribution, surface forces and adhesiveness. So these are the factors which influence the performance of the process, and the screw process produce high quality briquettes. This also produced high quality briquettes with a homogeneous structure and good combustibility, and require only little maintenance. So the main disadvantage is that the wear of the screw leads to elevate the cost of the spare parts. Okay. So the cost is, the operating cost may be higher because of the wear of the screw. Then we are coming to low pressure operation. So under low pressure operation, as you have mentioned, that we need to add some binder. So here biomass and waste will be mixed with some binder, and then initially some shape will be given, and then there will be some curing time. So that way we have to use some binder, and organic binders may be used or inorganic binders may be used. So different types of organic binders are provided here, that is bitumen, molasses, starch, coal tar, resin, and here's inorganic cement, lime, clay and sulphite liquor. So these have been reported and used for the briquette formation. And during the compaction process, the briquettes are brought into shape without giving them substantial strength, and after that a subsequent curing step, drying, burning, chemical reaction, etc., the green briquettes are formed. So these green briquettes developed and with the required strength and stability. Now we will see the comparison of different machines. So we have screw press, we have piston press, we have roller press, we have plate mills. So these two mills are high initial cost, but these can be used for the production of very large amount of products also. The throughput is high in these two cases. And if we compare, then we see the piston press, if we see the density, bulk density here, the piston press we are having less than 0.1, and here it is having 0.526, and it is 0.7 to 0.8. And if we see the specific energy consumption, then this is 37 to 150, 37 to 77 here, 30 to 83, and 16 to 75. So, this is also different for all the machines. So, these machines energy requirement we see also comparable, here it is higher, but these are comparable with this also, screw press also, but the these had advantage, but this will be producing more product and initial cost is high. Now, if we see about the output of the machine, so this screw process is a continuous, this is also continuous, pellet mill also continuous, but piston is our in strokes, that works in strokes. So, particle size you see 2 to 6 millimeter, here 6 to 12 millimeter, less than 4, less than 3 millimeter. So, we are giving bigger particles in this case, and the maintenance is low, here it is high, low, low. So, these are the different process for the densification which have been used, and this is the comparison. Now, when the briquettes is formed, the briquettes will be densified, it is fine, but still it will be having more volatile matter. So, when we will be using it, then it will be producing more smokes and we need to remove that. So, carbonization of the briquettes is done. So, carbonization process is required, as we mentioned that it increased the smoke generation, it also reduced ignition and burning properties, and then low heat value and not suitable under wet condition. These are the demerits of the briquettes, and the carbonization if we do, then these demerits will be reduced. And the carbonization is a partial pyrolysis process, it is heated up to 600 degree centigrade, and burnable gases like CO, CH4, H2, formaldehyde, methanol, formic and acetic acid, as well as non-burnable gases like CO2, H2O and liquid tar are released. So, if we heat it in absence of oxygen, then it will be converted to char along with these products. So, why we do this? By this carbonization, carbon content increases in the briquettes and volatile matter reduces. So, when we will use in combustion process, so smoke formation and tar formations will be reduced. The off gas of the process is of high energy value and can be used to balance the energy and heat demand of the carbonization, and this carbonization process can be done either after briquette formation or before briquette formation also the biomass and waste can be converted to char and then it will be made into briquette. So, here either carbonization followed by grinding and briquetting, or grinding followed by briquetting and carbonization, both are possible. Now, we will see the how the property changes due to the briquette formations and char formation. So, here the pine needle, so then pine needle char, then char to pine needle briquette. So, you see the basically volatile matter content in the pine needle, we are having 70.03%, when it is converted to char it is 17.96%, and then briquette it is 29.04%. So, briquetting process is helping us to reduce the volatile matter content. Now, we see the fixed carbon. So, here 15.83 for pine needle, for char it is 69.150 and here it is 52.85. So, briquetting process again helping us to get more fixed carbon in it. So, when it will be burned further in the combustion unit, it will be less amount of material will be required to release same amount of energy also. And you see the how the material changes. So, this is your pine needle and this is your char, and then these are the briquettes. Okay, ash content also changes here 4.37, 5.390 and 11.21, because it is converted into briquette form. Now, briquette characteristics, there are some properties the briquette should have, because briquettes has to be transport from one place to other place. So, one will be that is handling characteristics and another will be fuel characteristics. Our main objective is for the production of briquettes is to get energy from it. So, use it as a fuel in combustions. So, heating value, size and shape, heating value is the fuel property, size and shape is also the fuel properties, and it also helps the performance to achieve the performance of the reactor system. And then the Handling characteristics are bulk density, friability, resistance to humidity. These are very important properties, and now both are important, but if I want to get one type of property in a higher extent, then the other property may be compensative. So, the distinction is not always clear, that is these handling properties and fuel characteristics, this distinction is not always clear and sometimes they interfere with each other. For example, improving the handling characteristics by making a more dense briquette, if I produce more dense briquette so that it will be easy to transport, but or easy to handle, but at the same time it will be detrimental on its combustion, because combustion requires porous material, so more combustion will get. So, in that case we have to compromise. Then we will see the manual briquette machines, which are used in small scale, they are small machines and anybody can use it easily. So, here different parts are there, we have one base plates, so this is our base plates, and base plates will having some ejection piston. So, if you see here, we have one hydraulic jack here, so then the pistons are there, and ejection pistons and transmission rod. So, ejection piston center, so transmission rod will help the transmission of the force from the from this hydraulic machine to the plate, and ejection piston will help to press the materials in the die, and after when the lid will be opened, it will help to get the material out from it. So, then briquette die is also there, so these are the briquette die here, and then hydraulic jack, as I have discussed here. So, hydraulic jack, then transmission rod, then your ejection piston, and then we have base plate on it, and the lid is also there, the cover of it. So, then it will be covered, and then from the bottom hydraulic jack will work, and then that will be pressed, after that will be taken out by the ejection piston. So, in this case, if we have say 20 briquettes at a time it can produce. So, 20 transmission rod and 20 ejection piston if we have, then that area requirement will be 20 into pi r square. So, pi by 4 into d square, where d is the diameter of the die diameter. So, if the die diameter is 28 millimeter, for an example, then equal to 0.28 meter, then number of mold is equal to 20. So, total area is equal to 20 into pi r square or pi d square by 4, that is equal to 0.0123 meter square. So, this is the area requirement. Then in this case, so how much weight the hydraulic jack has to be lifted, let us see. So, mass of one pressure transmission rod is equal to say 450 gram, we are assuming this, and the number of pressure transmission rod is equal to 20. So, total mass of 20 transmission rods equal to this into this 9000 gram equal to 9 kg. Then mass of ejection piston, 20 numbers we have. So, 100 gram of weight we are assuming, so that 20 into 100, so 2000, that is equal to 2 kg we are getting here. Mass of the base plate is 4.5 kg we are assuming. So, maximum mass of one weight briquette sample is equal to 50 gram we are assuming it. So, the total mass of briquette samples equal to number of briquette sample into mass of one sample, that is equal to 20 into 50, that 1000 gram, that is equal to 1 kg. So, total mass to be lifted by the hydraulic jack is the total mass of the transmission rod, mass of base plate, total mass of ejection piston, and total mass of briquette samples. So, we have got 9 kg, 2 kg plus 4.5 kg plus 1 kg, so 16.5 kg. So, if g equal to 9.81 kg per second square, so then we are getting weight to be lifted equal to 16.5 into 9.81, that is equal to 161.87 newton. So, this is the weight we need to lift by the hydraulic jack. And then what is the force? What is the force that we have to calculate? How can you calculate the force? Then we will discuss now. Say a 10 tons hydraulic jack, we are using a 10 tons hydraulic jack, that is equal to 1 lakhs newton hydraulic jack, was used to lift the machine components and compress the briquettes. So, if this is the situation, then the compaction force can be calculated using the pressure. So, what will be the compaction force? That can also be calculated. So, pressure read from the pressure gauge connected to the hydraulic jack is equal to say 17.5 kilonewton per meter square. That is one example, that this is the pressure gauge is showing this reading, okay, and the machine has 20 moles. Then we can calculate what is the compaction force. What is the compaction force? We are getting the pressure here. So, what is the compaction force that I am interested to calculate? So, in that case, what we will do? Though we will use the formula pressure equal to force by area. So, pressure is given here. So, we have to calculate the area and we will get the force. So, in this case, area S is equal to 20, the 20 number of moles we have. So, 20 into pi by 4 into d square. So, that is equal to 0.0123 meter square. So, F C is equal to this AC into P, which is given here. So, that we are getting 0.2153 kilonewton, that is equal to 215.3 newton. So, that way we can calculate what is the pressure requirement. So, after this, in this class, thank you very much for your patience.